Title, Creating Impact, Creating Experience. And I'm going to call Tarmo Birki, who's going to be the moderator. He's the co-founder of Co-Founder Magazine. Please, big applause. Also, former AT&T Artist Startup, Tarmo. Welcome. And I'm going to call our next panelist. So please, Kei Shimada from Dentsu, Ohio. Arigato gozaimasu. Martin Brodnik from Spaces. Big applause, Martin. Thank you for joining us. Javier Laza from Prisa, Multimedia Director. And finally, but not least important, Ignacio Gaffro from IE Business School. Big applause. Thank you, guys. Stage is yours.
Thank you, Alex. Such a great day to be in Madrid. I was spending yesterday in Barcelona on the streets dancing with the locals. So it was a very nice experience to come here.
Everything. What was the occasion?
Independence.
Touchy.
Okay. But I mean, it's all about experiences, right? Dancing on the street is experience like any other. Building a startup could be a very similar experience. I wanted to kind of do a quick introduction round. Everybody to say, you know, what they actually do and what experience they have created they are really proud of and what impact did it have. Starting, you know, politely and with myself, of course, right, as a journalist, that's usually what happens. My name is Tarmo Birki, and I'm the co-founder of Co-Founder Magazine, which of course often creates nice smiles among the people. It's something like this. What I'm proud of, I mean, I'm really proud of actually making this thing. The experience of skimming through the papers and the articles on the paper pages at a time when all the startup media has turned into the bits and pieces and the data which is, you know, going quickly into the dustbin. I'm really proud of that.
That's awesome. All right. Hi, my name is Kei. I work for Japan's largest advertising agency called Dentsu, and we're known globally as Dentsu Agency Network. We also have a booth called Carrot today. What I do, I basically have three hats. I create my own businesses. Second, I evangelize our innovation that we create in Japan and connect 117 cities around the globe. So I'm more or less on the plane every other day. Third one is I speak to everybody about what you should be doing 3 to 5 years from now. The experience that I am very proud of is back in 2012 or 2011, maybe some of you know we had a very large earthquake and tsunami and nuclear disaster. In 2012, when I joined Dentsu, I created Japan's first comprehensive database of evacuation shelters. So it was the first, and we created apps, and we actually worked together with the government in crisis management, and it was the first. People were shocked that an advertising agency created such business. But I wanted the public to understand that even an advertising agency could create meaningful services. I'm not saying advertising is not meaningful, sorry for advertising people here. But yeah, so that's an experience that I'm very proud of, and I think I brought a lot of impact to Japan.
Martin Gordon from Amsterdam. I am the co-founder of Spaces. Spaces was an idea in 2006 to make the world better in a office environment to change the world of working. We are one of the first movers in the market to create that environment. So we redeveloped the building to only think about added values. So added value from a design perspective, from an art perspective, from a work environment perspective, from a community perspective, from a real destination to work. And that started indeed in 2008, the day Lehman Brothers fell, the day the crisis came, and we all know that so rethinking of the economy, about sharing, participating. And yeah, what I'm proud of, that idea is now rolling out globally. So we just opened in Madrid last month, very unique location. Currently in about 18 countries, more than 60 locations. So the dream of making the world better in a unique designed working place where we can indeed socialize, humanize, and connect as persons, it's now happening globally. And wherever you travel in the world, You can go through spaces.
Hi, good morning. I'm Javier Lazan, head of Multimedia. I'm responsible for multimedia experiences in Google Reason. Just media product with the experience of my dad, and also with radio and the most proud experiences. I mean, they are, from my point of view, how we interconnect the digital experiences and real world experiences with digital things or audio commanded interfaces. And my personal most proud experiences was creating a startup and studying 3D in Silicon Valley. And I learned a lot from how to interact with the market and with the product in a different way from this perspective of the last corporation.
Right. So good morning to everybody. I'm Ignacio Gaffo from IA Business School. I'm actually a dater, so I manage all the part-time programs. So you might say, well, education is somehow boring. No, absolutely not. It's going through a major disruption, okay? Mainly because of new technologies impacting. You know, think about Coursera, edX, etc. So quite a few knowledge over there, easily accessible. And also the profile of students is changing amazingly. You know, millennials, we speak about them, well, I deal with them. And actually, one of my main challenges is how I come up with both, right? How do we add value over a new thing is happening? And in this regard, we pick up one experience. I just redesigned the program upside down for the program I have for the top executives. And the challenge is basically how I contribute over the technologies available. They're combining of face-to-face, experiential, online learning. That's a big thing we came up with recently.
We have a lot of people on the panel here who are changing something. I myself have been really strongly talking about historic values. We actually make it on paper. We have a lot of media guys here on the stage also. What do you think about the depth of the paper as an experience?
It'll never happen. It'll never happen. Basically, when black and white television was introduced to the market, people were saying, people stopped going to movie theaters, right? It never happened. Right? There's probably some tangible things that people will still enjoy. And there are probably meaningful services that will go onto paper which cannot be replicated on digital. So I don't think it will be will disappear. How many of you think that paper will disappear in the next 10 years?
I'm a proud girl in the back.
You work for a digital agency. I can see that.
Yes.
Just kidding. That's my thought.
One is to make paper makes the world a bit beautiful, so you can connect, you can create, and you can give feeling about paper, which is can't be with digital. And this is what people love. People love to feel, to touch, to integrate, to share energy, and that is what paper does.
I think, Mark, in your world, the kind of analogy is probably like the remote working, right? You kind of build a beautiful working place for people to actually show up and experience the place also.
Yes.
While I love to lie on my couch, feet up, and drink coffee in my underwear while working.
Yeah, and the sound of a newspaper is just the crisping, energizing sound, and people love that.
You probably have a lot to say about that.
And probably it
would
be very difficult questions. I think that that paper makes no sense. It's very expensive to produce and distribute as well. And I think the digital experience, I think most of the newspaper people are thinking about shifting toward digital versions. Not just the newspaper, the physical product. I'm not saying that we will have lost most of the printing version, but I think there should be a link between the digital physical world, the printed version, and the digital experiences. But I must believe that we will go in very, very fast through digital experiences, especially through mobile devices.
I think about this kind of there something between the two worlds or connecting the two worlds. The industry has been talking about it for, you know, probably since before the internet, and it hasn't really happened.
We're talking about experiences in general, but I am a product guy. We measure, how we measure experiences is a key issue for us. I mean, from a media point of view, we are measuring experiences through impact, which is related with the business model. And we know that for younger audiences, the impact of the printing, we have large magazines as well, and newspapers. And I mean, we are losing users. They are shifting towards other means of in the creative experiences. It's like a photograph of, in a time, and we need this kind of. We are asking for a flow information all the time, and I think that we can cope with this kind of experience. But probably for weekends, for more relaxing, or for relaxing reviews and for other. And for other means rather than for news or for conversation, actually for learning or training or other, it will be. I mean, we will have printed edition for daily business.
Yeah, I totally agree with that part. The I haven't heard on the experience side yet people going to the toilet with their tablet to read that.
You just don't talk about it.
Maybe.
Digital is private.
Sorry about that.
Let me share my experience because it's an interesting one on education. We try to go paperless, you know, we try to get rid of all physical documentation. And interestingly, we got a very strong pushback from students, you know. They demanded physical books, a big large of them demanded physical books. And my take on this is whenever you want to concentrate and when you want to go deep reading, you need to print out. So maybe it's only 20% of what you read, and you know, so there's going to be a blend here. But if you want to, concentrate, you really print it out. You want to have that physical experience. So that's what my experience is telling me. So I think we're far from getting rid of that. I don't know generation set, but for the time being.
Yeah, there are surely some generation differences, surely, no question about it.
For example, the records are actually back, right?
Yeah. And also paper books.
Yeah, absolutely. And basically, it's not the 50s and 60-year-olds that grew up on records that are buying it. The majority of people are actually young people who are, you know, it's me. Yeah. What was that?
Emotion.
Oh, emotions, yeah.
Emotion and experience.
Yes, absolutely. They think it's cool. So, you know, maybe eventually when paper does disappear in 10 years.
I think she left.
Yeah, she's there, right? Paper might become cool again. Never know. Right, go on.
We are talking about printed edition, we are talking about one format, I mean text format. But I mean, I think that conversational media and audiovisual media, multimedia with audio videos, but I mean, we can fit this in the classical printing edition, given that we can fit the new audiovisual experience with a linear TV as well. We're going to shift there. Another trend in digital production is that we produce 1,800 hours of video streaming a year.
A day?
Yeah, we do. And 5,000 videos every month, new videos every month, 20,000 articles every month. I mean, all this amount of information is very difficult to fit in one format. The other way around is how to measure our experience. All of this content make the same impact. The answer is obviously small. I mean, 5% of our content create 80% of the impact. But we don't know which content.
In digital,
so we are using big data, artificial intelligence, and machine learning techniques to try to guess which are the content that we'll do that we will have more successful. But we are not thinking about a final format. There are many formats. This kind of a tweet, Facebook and live, VOD. I mean, we are mixing a kind of audio you can create it in a different that they can put it in your commuting. I mean, you can access a video, you can access a text. article connected to a video. We have a recommendation system for linking, for creating, for kind of creating or connecting the link of this experience, or make it as much as possible related with our content.
I guess that's something which is happening today is people get bored very easily. You know, we get so many inputs that we get bored very, very easily. So in other regard, we need to entertain people, but that's something I learned from making many mistakes. And in this case, a multi-format is a must-have. You know, if you stick to one format, it doesn't matter to me, people are going to get bored. So you need to diversify, you need to innovate.
But I have to ask you, how do you entertain people at the business school?
Well, in our case, what we try to do is we usually come with what we call war stories, which is basically we need to make sure that people are connecting whatever they are teaching with their day-to-day life, you know? So if you want to promote engagement, and I'm sure we'll agree, engagement is vital here, they need to be part of the story, you know? They should be the ones leading the story, not the ones receiving information. That's something students are not going to take anymore. So you need to engage with them, come up with something which is going to involve them, see a real application, combine different formats, and then you would come up with a very nice show, I believe.
Keiichi, you said that you often go around talking to the people what they will be doing in 3 to 5 years. I mean, it's a fascinating topic. What we will be doing in 3 to 5 years, and how, kind of looking from the perspective of the kind of experience creation.
Are you going to pay me?
Just kidding. Organize as well.
Basically, there's a lot of aspects to that, so it depends on industry, where the client is, what they're trying to measure, what they're trying to deliver as an experience. So there's a lot of aspects that go into it. One thing that I'm focused right now is to basically help with the architecture of creating experience and then measuring impact through emotions. So today at 3 o'clock, somewhere around like 3 o'clock, I'll be talking about mind hacking. So one of the businesses that I do is actually do business around neuroscience. So we have a device that taps into your subconscious and identifies 5 emotional states of mind in real time. So we're utilizing that technology to basically evaluate the experience and produce quantified data from the emotions that come from your brains, and then add that to qualitative feedback that comes verbally. You know how people are unreliable. You ask about the experience and the impact, and people will say, maybe I liked it. You know, yes, when they mean no, you know, they'll say no when they mean yes. People are basically unreliable. And as a company, if you're trying to measure impact, right, and have very good feedback, you can't accumulate maybes, right? So basically, we're using technology that is a little far out there, but it has been proven to work and help companies perfect a product design or service design for a sales pitch or perfect a TV commercial before it's launched or a venue item, what have you. Anything that you need to measure experience, we can utilize technology that is 3 to 5 years from now in the mass, but use it today in order to basically refine a product development strategy or the end product itself. So that's one of the ways that we can help clients understand what they should be doing 3 to 5 years from now.
So basically, in 5 years from now, when people come to South Summit, they will be getting a headset at the door, and then they will be throwing us off the stage.
Yes, based on their emotions, without even having to say, I hate you, right? But technology is growing exponentially. You've probably read about it. We all agree. Now we have a headset, an EEG headset that has a sensor that sort of like touches your forehead. The FP1 area is where all of the emotions are generated. But eventually it'll be in the form of earphones. When you jog, based on your emotions, you would be recommending music that would pump yourself up. And eventually when you sit in the car, and if you're still driving, if it's not level 5 autonomous driving, the minute that you sit in the car and you grab the steering wheel, right, your emotions would be monitored, and basically if you're in a good mood, maybe it will recommend a nice winding road for a nice drive, and if you're in a bad mood, it won't allow you to go over 50 kilometers per hour, for example. That's, I think, what we really need. Yeah.
Interesting future.
It's the future.
seems, in a way, in my eyes.
You still use paper.
No, I love it.
Yeah, people use iPads these days to say, all right, what was the next question? And you have very neat handwritten papers.
Very good. Very good. I like often comparisons with food.
Okay.
It's not going to die.
No, but if you go to a really nice restaurant, you always know the first course and the last one, the third, fourth, fifth, you're like, what is it? But the experience and the coloring, and indeed also the growth of the food industry to get it more smarter, easier, more sustainable, ecological, but also what we eat, the science we eat, it's all changing rapidly. And that we, when we started Spaces, was this also the ideas of, we wanted to create a work environment that feels like home, because you have the art, the right design, you have the right feeling, the right music, the right coloring and light, and we believe that you can become more productive. So it's all about stimulation. I think stimulation is very, and now you can measure it. And in the end, from a social engagement, stimulation is a very unique driver to get ideas, which is still very human.
I think this food and the focus on the quality of food is really interesting compared to the media industry. How can you do it in the media industry that the audience will actually get better, not crappier quality in a digital form?
I wish that you asked me about media and food. My family owns 8 restaurants.
That was a relevant question.
in different cities, different countries, in London, Barcelona, Bilbao. And I came from the restaurant that little company. But I haven't worked in the digital industry. We think that the not just the content on the product, the experience, but also with the device and the interface. And when we started working with iPhone in 2008, we found that the user interact differently with the tactile, with the finger, and with the mouth, they consume differently. I mean, I agree with your opinion that we measure that the attention span of the user is getting lower. We have a 60% of attention span in a medium conversion rate from 100%. But when you put advertising in front, you get lower to 50%. I mean, we have to measure also the experience of advertising and the program content. It's not a problem for us. It's product and advertising. We are talking about issues about brand safety, ad fraud. We are measuring also sentiment analysis of the content, because most of the people think that newspaper like El País is talking about Barcelona, Mexico, Las Vegas killing. They are good news, they are interesting news, but they are related with bad emotions. We're trying to deliver this kind of emotional map of the newspaper. We have employed to where that, because we have to work with brands, with programmatic advertising, also gets a lot of fraud, not advertising getting. So the technology gets, we get from the technology a lot of new resources, but we get new challenges that we have to.
But what you're saying, in a way, that building a newspaper is increasingly like doing a movie.
I don't know.
You will have hidden advertising there. This Volvo car coming with a good family, and the crooks are going on a BMW away, and the kind of emotional chapter building that the story never drops anywhere.
Yeah,
it has a great similarities, I would say.
Formerly, the newspaper was made by journalists, and they created the agenda. Nowadays, with usual interaction, we have the agenda. I mean, we have tools that tell us that most of the most read news, they are not in the first scroll above the folder. They are inside the is that the people sometimes are fed about politics, or they're asking for other content, and having tools for taking this or being aware of this real time is key for production. The production of experience has changed. We are in a project for creating also a massive experience with augmented reality and virtual reality as well. We have a project with Google, we are working with Bagger, with innovation. They give us a grant for the innovation grant, the Google D&I project for creating an immersive infographic, graphic news created in an immersive environment. We had to test users. We don't know how they are going to interact with this immersive with data and with information. This is always a learning curve, and they are also having a new measurement. But having said that, most of our measure resources are very focused for related with our business model. We sell impressions, we say payroll, so we measure unique user and impressions. But I think this is, in this new environment, the virality, the sentiment, the user sentiment, the content engagement, there are certain values that they are not related for with a market value, but we have to put this in front of the market and the user as well.
In a way, of course, with this constant measurement, the kind of point of the media and the media experience has changed a lot. Every journalist knows that, 10, 20 years ago, we put the dogs and the children on the picture, then you get all the feedback and all the responses. Today, of course, it has gone a little bit beyond the dogs and children, where the clicks are.
We are not measuring just the product of content, how many people they are interacting, how many people, the quality of the content, how many is they think is good, but conversational values of the content. So we are not just focusing on how many impressions we get from an article or a video, which is the engagement based on measurable KPI, like how many times they are sharing the content in different social platforms, in the time that you're spending content, interaction with the content, conversation, how many content you are related to or the user is accessing, and get very challenging, but difficult. And we have to put new tools because manually, with the standard tools, we can cope with all this,
I have to apologize to the university and the office space. There were too many media guys on stage. Thank you, gentlemen. Our time is up. Thank you.